This
is TLV1.
TLV1 Radio.
Great, great mixture.
I like Tel Aviv.
This is TLV1.
This is
Tel Aviv is a beautiful city.
Great city, great radio.
TLV1.
This is TLV1.
The Tel Aviv Review with Gilad Halpern.
Hello and welcome to the Tel Aviv Review, a program dedicated to the word, to the thought and to debate. I am your host, Gilad Halpern. And on our show today, we'll be talking to Dr. David Schorr, who teaches at the School of Law at Tel Aviv University. He specializes in history of environmental law. He will be discussing his recent study on the evolution of water law in Palestine under the British mandate. Our second guest will be Dr. Rachel Pear, a teaching assistant at the School of Education at Bar-Ilan University and a postdoctoral fellow at the University of Haifa. She specializes in Jewish Orthodox attitudes to Darwinism and the theory of the evolution. We will hear from her about that. This is our show today. Do stay tuned and we'll be back after this bit of music.
Got to.
You're listening to TLV1. This is the Tel Aviv Review. Welcome back. I am now joined here in the studio by Dr. David Schorr, who teaches at the School of Law at Tel Aviv University and specializes in the history of environmental law. And we're here to discuss your recent study of the evolution of water law in Palestine under the British mandate. Hello, David, and welcome to the Tel Aviv Review.
Hello, thank you for inviting me.
So the Mandate era was a momentous period in the history of this country in many, many, many ways, no doubt. And I'm asking myself, what insight does the study of water law offer into our knowledge of that period? Why focus on water law in the first place?
Well, two answers to that question. The first is I actually came to this topic not from an interest in the history of the mandate period, although I am interested in that, but from a wider interest in the history of water law in general around the world. And so I figured one interesting place to study this would be where the history of water law where I live, here in Israel. And it turns out that the period of British rule was an important period for the development of water law here. But if you know, getting back to actually answer your question, I think, you know, most studies of the mandate period rightly focus on politics, on Jewish-Arab relations, on the question of Jewish national home, would it become a state, would it not, on Aliyah, immigration, particularly from Europe in the years of anti-Semitism and the Holocaust. So all those are huge topics, obviously very important. But there's a large number of topics which at the time were very important and still continue to affect our lives in many ways.
But all those issues that you enumerated now are enmeshed into water law. Isn't it like a microcosm of everything that Palestine stood for?
That's right. So if in the beginning my motivation was in some sense to get away from those bigger and well-worn topics, I thought. In the end, it turns out to be very hard to get away from them. So the story of water law during the British period here turns out to be very enmeshed, as you said, with the history of Jewish-Arab relations and the Zionist movement and relations of both groups with the British, absolutely.
Yeah. So, but you know, the evolution of water law, I would imagine, that is just one aspect of the huge process of modernization that the British rulers of this country sought to engage in, and in many ways did.
I think that's right. And although, you know, the modernization is a loaded word, so I certainly think the British saw it that way. They saw themselves as modern. They saw the Ottomans, who had been here before them, as backwards, even primitive. The Zionists tended to identify with the British way of looking at things, I think. In some ways, the Zionists were more modern and more modernist than the British. On the other hand, you know, it's not so simple. The Ottomans on their own had been undergoing process of modernization over the decades before.
Okay, so forget the word modernization. Right. I might have taken you to a corner that I wouldn't wish us to, I wouldn't wish us to go down. But say, maybe use a more neutral word like regulation. So that's, as far as I understand, the main novelty of British water law as opposed to the Ottoman law.
Yes, that's right. And in that sense, it is modernization of things that are it's parallel in some way to things that are happening all around the world at the time or in the years before that. Although you have to look, when you look at Britain itself, it's interesting. British water law did not undergo this modernizing process, not at the time and to a large extent not even today. So that the British water law, English water law, even today, looks a lot more like Ottoman water law than it does like Israeli water law.
Okay, now you have to explain what it means.
So Israeli water law is actually somewhat famous around the world for being an almost radical approach in that the state of Israel, controls all the water sources in the country. It is, by law, the state is the owner of all water sources in the country, whether it's underground water, lakes, streams, puddles, and of course today what's very important is artificial water, you know, desalinated water, treated sewage, etc. Now, that Israel is almost an extreme case of state ownership, and that's based on a law from 1959, the Israeli water law of 1959, which has been looked at around the world as being an exemplar of that kind of approach. In most of the world, there is at least some room for private property in water, and at the time, you know, at the time we're talking about British control over Palestine, in probably most places in the world, water was a form, was considered a form of private property. And like I said, the British still pretty much hewed to that approach. So what I thought was interesting about this period was that the British attempted to introduce something that looks very much like the Israeli water law, starting as early as the 1920s.
But that would make perfect sense in a country where water is scarce. And it's a valuable resource because both communities in this country, the Palestinian and the Jewish community, relied heavily on water supply because the main industry was agriculture at the time. You know, the Palestinians for historical reasons and the Jews for ideological reasons because they sought to engage in agricultural work, the kibbutzim and all that jazz. So it would make perfect sense that there would be one ruler who would regulate the distribution of this valuable natural resource.
Well, yeah, you might think so. And certainly that's one approach that's been taken by theorists and by historians. There's a very famous theorist, Karl Wittfogel, a German emigre to the U.S., who wrote a famous book on Oriental despotism, where he claimed that despotisms of the sort we find in ancient Egypt and other places arose out of control.
It's a popular theme among German theorists.
That's right. So he argued that it came because of the importance of water and state control of water. On the other hand, probably the extreme example most people think about, those who think about water law, of private property in water is from the Western United States, which has a climate very similar to Israel's. It's a pretty water-stressed region. And yet the solution of the law in that case has been pretty extreme private property. Mm-hmm. So there's not, I think, there's not
to,
really
to encourage personal private initiative, right,
exactly.
And competition, etc.
Exactly, and mm-hmm. husbanding of the resource, and you know, the idea sort of being that the market will best allocate the water as opposed to the state. So I don't think you can really, when you look at it historically, or even in terms of economic theory, I don't know that you can necessarily draw a straight line between scarcity and state control. But that was one of the motivating factors, as you said. Both Zionists thought that state control would aid them in their development projects for their agricultural settlements, for the expanding cities.
But still, the reform that the British tried to introduce into water law in this country met with fierce opposition from the Zionist camp.
That's right. So at the beginning, in the late 20s and the early 30s, the Zionists actually worked hand in glove with the British in formulating these new laws. And that's because, you know, what we just said, that they thought this would help in development of the country. At a certain point, as the British policy in general became less friendly to Zionist endeavors, so we have the famous White Paper of 1939, where British limit immigration, they limit land sales to Jews in Palestine. The Zionists, sensing the change in, you know, in British policy, come to see the idea of state regulation of water as another branch of the White Paper. And they even use that term. They say this is a white paper for water. We don't want the government to have control over water anymore. So the Zionists do a complete 180-degree turn and vehemently oppose British efforts to reform water law.
Is it just because they lost faith in the British rulers, or was it something more substantial, you know, more relevant to the issue of water per se?
Yeah, so I mean that's one of the things I'm still trying to figure out. I think certainly the overwhelming motivation was just they realized that the government was hostile to them. So now that made them change their ideas about whether government control was a good thing or a bad thing. And the interesting thing is they flip-flop again in the 1950s. Right now that the Zionists are in control, they flip-flop again and decide that state control, after all, is a good thing. And the Israeli water law of 1959 actually pretty much reflects the British approach that Zionists had opposed in the 1940s. So one of the things I'm interested in is did this experience, though, of opposing state control, did it, and how did it affect the ultimate shape that Israeli water law took. The experience of being in the minority, the experience of being out of power, did it affect Israeli water law once the Zionists were in power? And I think it did in some minor ways. For instance, Israel has a water court, which not many people know about.
I don't.
It's part of the court system of the state of Israel. There's a water court in Haifa, and it decides on questions of water use. And I think
to this day,
And
such as what? I mean, can I sue you in the water court because you stole water from me, or how does it work?
Yeah, well, I actually can't steal water from you, right? Because all the water belongs
to
the government.
Sure, of course. But
if you think, for instance, that you were not allocated the amount of water that you should have been allocated by the government, you can sue the government in water court. Or if two users are interfering with each other's use, they could sue each other in water court.
And do people actually do that?
Yes. I mean, it's not as common as lawsuits in the regular courts.
All right.
But there are there is activity in the water court all the time. Every now and then, cases go up, get appealed up to the Supreme Court as well. And I think that was a result partially of the Zionist experience of being out of power, so that when they enacted the law in 1959, they said, wait, we don't want to give the state total control of the water. We want the private citizens, or they were probably thinking of kibbutzim and moshavim,
yeah,
to have a way of opposing government power. And so we'll at least give them an outlet. They can go to court and get an impartial hearing on whether the government's oppressing them or not when it comes to
But life. Isn't it just, you know, a charade at the end of the day? Because at the time, in 1959, in the 50s and 60s, the makeup of the Israeli market and government was highly collectivist, and everything was branched in some way or another to the government. Do you suggest that water in this case was somewhat separate from this paradigm?
No, not at all. I mean, water is probably the classic example of that paradigm. The national water carrier is built and opened in those years. When one settlement, Pardes Chana, does go to court in the 1960s and says, hey, the government stole our water because we've been using this spring for decades, and now all of a sudden the government's telling us that the water belongs to it and not to us. So Bagatz, the Israeli High Court of Justice, actually sides with the government. So the statist approach is very dominant in these years, along with, you know, just as it is in many other areas of life. But the fact that someone, and, you know, it's more than one person, it's the experts who drafted the law and it's the Knesset who passed the law, nonetheless put some protections into the law for the protection of the private citizen, I think is significant.
Mm-hmm. Now, be kind, rewind to 1925, 1926, when there's perhaps the watershed moment in the enactment of British water law in Palestine, and, you know, departure from the Ottoman system. That was the Artas affair, where there was a small village in the West Bank near Bethlehem that actually sued the government, similar to the Pardes Chana case that you just cited, sued the British government for stealing the water they had been using for centuries.
That's right. This is a fascinating case. I mean, it's a somewhat famous case among Israeli legal historians, although it hasn't been thought about in terms of water law in particular. And the reason it's a famous case is it's possibly the first instance where the High Court of Justice strikes down legislation. In 1925, there's a water shortage in Jerusalem, and the Jews have been building new neighborhoods all over the place. Places like Talpiot and Beit HaKerem are being built, and there's not enough water for the city. So the government decides to take water from Artas, which is where Solomon's pools are south of Bethlehem, a place that had been supplying Jerusalem with water really for millennia, or, you know, since Roman times at least. But the British decide to increase pumping there. And the locals complain. They say, you don't have the right to take our water. So the British quickly pass a law. In record time, they pass a law in a few days, and the law says the government can take all the water from Artas, and they have to compensate the residents under certain conditions. The residents are not happy with that, and they go to the High Court of Justice, which, as like it is today, is part of the Supreme Court, and they say this law is unconstitutional. Now, what does that mean, unconstitutional? As we know, Israel still doesn't have a real kinds of constitution. Mm-hmm. In the 1920s, there was no document called the Constitution. What they mean is they say this law is opposed to the mandate for Palestine, which was given by the League of Nations. Because the League of Nations mandate says that the British have to protect the civil rights of all the inhabitants. And these Palestinian residents come and say, look, the British are violating our civil rights by taking our property without mm-hmm. without sufficient compensation. So this goes to the...
Because they did offer them compensation, just not enough.
That's right. They offered them compensation under some conditions, but not others. And it was by a special tribunal with no right of appeal. So the Supreme Court, which is staffed by British judges here in sitting in Jerusalem, pretty close to the beginning of the British rule, takes a look at this claim and says, you're right. This law was passed is unconstitutional. So it's really a fascinating case. We tend to think of the Israeli constitutional revolution as having taken place in the 1990s under the leadership of President of the Supreme Court, Aaron Barak. So here you have a case 70 years beforehand where the British-controlled Supreme Court strikes down a law as being unconstitutional. The British then appeal this to the Privy Council in London, which is sort of a Supreme Court for the British Empire. And the Privy Council overrules the Palestine Court's decision based on some considerations which we don't have to get into, but it does affirm the principle that legislation in Palestine has to conform to the League of Nations mandate. So it does affirm the principle that there is a sort of constitution. So this is a fascinating case for constitutional law. The Jews tried to make use of this kind of argument as well during the mandate period.
So what you're saying is that it just happened to be water, but the real significance is far beyond the issue of water.
Right. It certainly has significance far beyond water. It has significance in international law because it's one of the cases that sets the principle that powers that are given trusteeship of colonies, in the League of Nations period, they called them mandates. After World War II, they started calling them trusteeships, that they have certain responsibilities under international law, which they have to meet. So it's an they can't just pass whatever law they want. Mm-hmm. So that's an important principle for that. It's an important principle for constitutional law, but it's also important for water law because for a number of reasons. First of all, you see it's an attempt by the British to assert state control of water pretty early on, at least in one area. You see the opposition by the locals based on arguments from private property, which actually were not very strong arguments, legally speaking. It's interesting. If you look at the Ottoman laws, which controlled the case, it's not clear that the local residents actually had the rights to all that water. The British certainly could have argued in court that they didn't.
But the thing was, during the Ottoman period, that water was just up for grabs, more or less, right?
To some extent. I mean, there's all kinds of opposing and contradictory statements in the Ottoman law, in the civil code called the Majella and some other places. Some seem to say that certainly when it comes to underground water, anyone can take underground water. And by the way, that's still the case in many places in the world, mm-hmm. that's the law, which means that if I have a well, my neighbor can dig a well next to my property and suck out all the water, which most people think is not a good legal rule, but that's still the law in many places and was probably the law at the time in the 1920s. The British, though, they could have used that argument in court. They didn't. So that actually sets the tone in a way where the British recognizing private property claims that were actually stronger than the law actually warranted. Mm-hmm. And I think that sort of sets the tone for the Zionist opposition that came later in the 1940s.
So going back indeed to the political minefield, I would call it, of between the Jews and the Arabs during the 30-year mandate period, do you see the water issue as yet another stick with which the Arabs and the Jews bashed each other? Or does it stand out in any way?
Well, I think it's in some ways it was a cardinal issue more than just another issue. Not so much on the legal front, but if you think about, for instance, where the Zionists placed their settlements, it was all based on considerations of water supply. I mean, among other things, but especially if you wanted an agricultural settlement, there had to be water. So the famous Choma u'Migdal, the tower and stockade settlements. So what was the tower? The tower was a water tower. Among other things, and that was because you couldn't live in these places without a water supply. So that also that has a legal aspect to it. So the Zionist organizations come to realize as they're setting up these tower and stockade settlements that they don't want government regulation of water supply because that will stop them from setting up these settlements.
Exactly.
They might be able to succeed in buying the land, but if they don't have water, the land is worthless. So they actually come to like the sort of unregulated system. But the places they chose were governed by water. The borders of the country were to a large extent determined based on considerations of water supply. Both the borders of the mandate where the British, the Zionists pushed the British also to include water sources in the north and the upper Galilee. Mm-hmm. And then the places that Israel, the young state of Israel, decided to defend or not to defend were also largely shaped by where they felt, which water supplies they needed and where they planned to run the pipes for the water carriers. Mm. So it actually, water played a huge role, as it must in this region.
Yeah, exactly. And it did for many, many years afterwards. Mm-hmm. Dr. David Schorr, I'm afraid this is all we have time for. So thank you very much for coming. You're a historian of environmental law at Tel Aviv University. Thank you very much for coming in and telling us all we needed to know about the history, the evolution of water law in Mandatory Palestine. Thank you
so much. Thank you very much for having me.
The farmer over there hits again. The poor people on the barns get it so rough. The truck driver drives like the devil. The policemen, they acting so tough. They need water. Good water. We need water. And I'm sure there ain't one of us here who'd say no to somebody's daughter. My Chevrolet just made steam. Your club is laying fire. My grass cuts lost its green. I'm alive. Maybe somebody's daughter. Indian Lake is burning. We'll be right back.
sure there ain't one of us here who'd say no to somebody's daughter. Wow!
You're listening to the Tel Aviv Review here on TLV1. Welcome back. And I'm now delighted to be joined by Dr. Rachel Pear. She's a teaching assistant at the School of Education at Bar-Ilan University and a postdoctoral fellow at the University of Haifa, specializing in Jewish Orthodox attitudes to Darwinism and the theory of evolution. Hi, Rachel, and welcome to the Tel Aviv Review.
Hi, Gilad. I am delighted to be here.
Great. Now, it seems to me almost a contradiction in terms, because the whole debate and the controversy around Darwinism and theory of the evolution, etc., isn't that a Christian thing?
Well, you would think so. And in fact, a lot of people have thought so. For example, Stephen Jay Gould, when he was speaking only in the 1990s, made a very famous statement that creationism is a very local phenomenon. He thought it was a very American phenomenon. He thought it was a very Christian phenomenon. And historians of science like Ronald Numbers have proven that he was actually very wrong in that statement, no matter how brilliant he was in so many ways. It is something that is around the world and equally strong in Europe, in Asia, in the Middle East, in
lots of
places.
So why is it that we laymen think that only crazy Christians are obsessed with creationism?
Well, Darwin himself was within the Christian faith, and so that's the initial context that it was debated in England, certainly. But almost immediately, you know, it spread and was discussed in other contexts, like the Jewish one. And to this day, it is just as much of an issue, if not more so, in many other religious contexts like Islam.
Yeah, actually, it would make perfect sense because, you know, obviously a heretical theory like the theory of the evolution would stand in diametrical opposition to the Holy Scriptures, whatever religion
and
domination you're for.
Well, not necessarily. I mean, there were certainly religious leaders of all faiths that have made their peace with evolution from the beginning in all sorts of different permutations, and that's actually fascinating. That was one thing that I found personally extremely interesting in my dissertation.
Yeah, so let's take them by one, or not one by one, but along the path of history, if you will. How would you, take us through the tumultuous, I would say, relationship between Jewish Orthodoxy and Darwinism from its very outset to today?
Okay, sure. And just the comment I was going to make a second ago, just in terms of comparative religion. For example, I grew up as an Orthodox Jew. I'm still an Orthodox Jew. So my study was reflexive in the sense that it was looking at my own community. It was looking at modern Orthodoxy. And when I went...
And that is in America, we should say. Our listeners could judge from your accent, but we should...
My dissertation was about America, but my current postdoctoral research is about Israel. Mm-hmm. And both contexts are extremely interesting.
We'll get to the comparative aspect in a minute, because it is interesting to look at America as opposed to Israel. I'd like to hear about what were the initial reactions of Jewish Orthodox leaders to Darwinism when it first emerged.
I'm getting to that.
In the middle of the 19th century, in the 1850s, was it, right?
Yeah, 1859 was the publication of The Origin of the Species. And I will get to that in 1 minute. If I just had
sure.
this. I was brought up in this modern Orthodox tradition, which said there was no problem with evolution. And actually, when I went on to study archaeology, I specifically chose prehistoric archaeology because I felt this was something that maybe would be less complicated even than biblical archaeology or other things like that. And then then I went on to find in Israel and in other places how much more complicated prehistoric archaeology and the theory of evolution is for certain religious leaders. Mm-hmm. And all I wanted to say was the same things I heard as a child in a Jewish Orthodox upbringing in terms of different ways that scriptures and evolution have been synthesized that I thought were Jewish answers to the question. When I became a researcher, I saw that the same answers were given in Christianity also in the beginning of the 20th century. Uh-huh. And there was a lot of openness to things that now are considered much more controversial within Christianity. Mm. So I'll go back to the beginning, but I just want to say there have been a lot of changes over the 20th century. So in terms of Jewish responses to Darwin, when Darwin first published his work, my dissertation doesn't begin until 1925 mm-hmm. in America. But basically, there were rabbis from the beginning who said that there were no problem, like Abraham Isaac HaCohen Cook, who's a very famous mm-hmm. personality here in Israel. He actually wrote extremely positively about evolution. He said that it's the world coming around to a Jewish perspective on reality. Mm-hmm. He really liked the idea of life continually growing, and obviously he saw it in a very positive sense of there being progress
as
in this evolution.
As the forefather of the Israeli version of modern Orthodoxy, also known as religious Zionism, right?
Yes. Mm-hmm. And he wrote very, very positively about evolution, and he had no qualms about Genesis not being a text that should be taken literally. And he had actually problems with people who took Genesis uh-huh. literally. So that's one example of a very positive view of evolution. So one of my questions in the dissertation then is, if there was this precedent of great Jewish thinkers and leaders embracing evolution, why did I find that even within American modern Orthodoxy, there are always voices of dissent, always people raising a question, maybe this theory of evolution really isn't kosher, can't be blended well with our tradition. And I found different answers in different decades, which was very interesting. Mm-hmm. For example, in the 1920s, when it was the famous Scopes trial, the trial that's sometimes called the monkey trial, yeah. or the trial of the century.
Is this
in
why
Tennessee.
You started focusing on the question in the 1920s? Or
yeah, that's mm-hmm. why I began the study there. Mm-hmm. It was actually Noah Ephron's suggestion, one of my right. dissertations. Mm-hmm.
And the host of the amazing Promise podcast here on TLV1. Yeah.
Can't give enough plugs for Noah. Uh-huh. So what I found were, I actually looked at two different rabbis who were both had congregations on the Upper West Side of Manhattan. And were publishing in the same modern Orthodox journal called the Jewish Forum. And they published very different reactions, basically in 1926, to the theory of evolution. Mm. There was one, David de Sola Poole, who was the rabbi of the Spanish and Portuguese synagogue, who wrote only positively about evolution. And there was another rabbi, Rabbi Leo Young, who was the rabbi of the Jewish Center, just a few blocks away, who published things that sounded, much more adversarial and skeptical about evolution. And basically what I found, one of the possible differences there, was that Rabbi Young and his congregation had just had a very difficult battle with Mordechai Kaplan, who was the previous rabbi of that synagogue, who founded the Reconstructionist movement in those very years. And Darwinism and evolution was a central tenet of Reconstructionism generally as a religious philosophy. And it seems to me that one of the main reasons that these American modern Orthodox Jews were questioning this theory of evolution was it caused one man within their own ranks. He grew up modern Orthodox. He was trained in the same seminary as a lot of these rabbis. He was working in modern Orthodox congregations. And then his radical ideas became to be known. And it seems like maybe they were connected to Darwinism. It was a subversive element that, at least in their view, maybe we need to be a little bit cautious about.
Would it be
about.
Too cynical to assume that they used Darwinism as a stick to bash each other with in some sort of infighting within their own community? Or was it more substantial than that?
I wouldn't necessarily go with the cynical reading on this one. I think they were, genuinely concerned. Mm. A lot of times we think about Orthodox Judaism and Judaism in general, I've heard people talk about Judaism as a religion of practice mm-hmm. as opposed to belief. That in Christianity, people care about beliefs. In Judaism, we care about practice. And this was one of those periods that we see people were saying it's not only about practice, because Reconstructionist Judaism at the time was actually very interested in Jewish practice. And they said, look, there's also an element of dogma, of orthodoxy, of things, beliefs that we hold dear. And maybe this certain belief that rabbis have said is okay and in totally in concert with real traditional Jewish theology. You know, I think they really weren't sure.
But this still is within the realm of modern orthodoxy. How does it play out in ultra-orthodoxy on the one hand and more progressive, I don't know, reform communities on the other?
Okay, so Reform Judaism was really interesting because there was a lot of debates about evolution earlier on when Darwin first wrote. And in the end of the 19th century, there were very vigorous debates about whether evolution could be synthesized with Reform Judaism. And it's interesting there in terms of what we were just discussing, because specifically in Reform Judaism, it's not as much practice. It's more beliefs that are important, more values in terms of morality and ethics. And the question of what does Darwinism mean for what it means to be a human being and what it means to be an ethical human being in an ethical world. And Reform rabbis were really raising questions about that. And that battle lasted for more than a decade, and then it was resolved, and then Reform Judaism made its peace with Darwinism and with evolution.
When was that?
That was in the 1880s. The main battles were raging and then resolved. And in terms of Orthodox Judaism, in terms of ultra-Orthodox Judaism, one scholar, Mark Swetlitz, who has been writing on Judaism and evolution now for a number of years and is thinking of publishing further on ultra-Orthodoxy, one of his contentions is actually that the opposite occurred there, in that there was more of a broad spectrum of views that was accepted earlier on, and that nowadays it's actually coalescing into a more anti-evolution perspective. So I felt that modern Orthodoxy, which was a group in between the more liberal movements in Judaism and the more conservative ultra-Orthodox movements in Judaism, sort of felt that tension and sort of remained in tension with the question throughout the period I investigated. And they had elements within them that just wanted to make peace and say there's no issue here, and elements that were always sort of raising the question.
To what extent was it really in response to the centrality of this debate in American society at large? Was it in some way a mirror image of it?
It's very interesting to watch that dance between what's happening in Christianity and what's happening in Judaism. And one of the key periods for that is actually the 1960s, which is when historians of science see the current creationist movement really taking off and really beginning its current march to triumph in Christianity. And what I found in American Orthodoxy was that was a very important period for the resurgence of the issue. I looked at an association called the Association of Orthodox Jewish Scientists. This organization was started in 1948, not ironically. And I found the name of the person who started this organization. He started
Ben-Gurion.
It in New York City. His name was Elmer Offenbacher, and I saw that he was a professor of physics in Temple University. So I wrote an email to a Temple University email. Lo and behold, I got an answer. The man lives across the street from me in Jerusalem.
Wow, amazing.
And he was sitting in an office in Givat Ram in Hebrew University while I was sitting in the National Library. And I've had the chance to sit and meet with him. And he is a very interesting person and has helped me chronicle the history of this organization. And both from his testimony and from my search within the documents of this organization, evolution did not arise as an important issue in the late 1940s and the 1950s, only in the 1960s, when it became an issue for Christians in America. And basically, there was a change in textbooks at that time in America. There was Sputnik, where we failed in the space race in 1958. The Russians beat us, and the American government said, we need to look at our science curriculum. And one of the things they did was say, we need to make sure we're teaching evolution. And that was
because
one
that
of
would
the...
get you to space, yeah.
Well, it was just sort of saying, what are we teaching, what are we not teaching? And that caused a lot of the argumentation. And as I said, I met with Dr. Offenbacher, who's never had a problem with evolution, but I also met with people who are living today here in Israel, because the majority of the Association of Orthodox Jewish Scientists, many of them have moved to Israel, and I got to meet them face to face. And I got to meet people who looked me in the eye, who are intelligent people, who are accomplished people, who told me that evolution is imaginary, that it's not true. And I talked to these people, and one of them was a survivor of the Holocaust and did so much in his scientific career. And that was a real experience, meeting these people face to face and really understanding that these are accomplished scientists. Maybe they're not biologists, they're not paleontologists, they're physicists or in other areas, but they truly believe that on the scientific evidence, they do not accept Darwinism to this day.
Let's take it to Israel, because you said many of them have moved to Israel, and we are here in Israel.
And one of them testified in front of the Knesset committee that is currently discussing the situation.
Exactly. So it's also topical, because in Israel, unlike America, as far as I can remember, it was never a serious issue or a hotly debated issue until quite recently. And that is, despite the fact that, I'd say, religious, I wouldn't call it dogma, but religious themes and elements feature heavily in the school curriculum and in the public debate in general. How do you explain that?
Well, yes, people love to, you know, agree with Stephen Jay Gould and think this is an American issue, but evolution has popped up in a few places. Even in, let's say, the conversion issue, it was raised if it should be an issue for people who are converting to Judaism to accept things like creationism, or for the rabbis that are converting them. It's popped up in those discussions. But maybe here in Israel, unfortunately, sometimes we take the approach of not addressing things face on, because it's just too much, it's too hard, it's too complicated. So we just sort of stick with a status quo, so to speak, and that's one of the things that happened here. Evolution was never mandated as a requirement within the science curriculum in a few different places. Also in the Megama for biology, if you took that as a major in high school, the evolution unit was optional there. And now what they're discussing in the Knesset is Shai Piron's decision the education minister, that it should be taught in the junior high school science curriculum. Now, one of the things,
interestingly enough, Shai Piron is a rabbi. He's an Orthodox rabbi.
Yes, but and one of the things he did there, again, the question is maybe to make it less controversial. He said, let's only teach animal evolution. We don't have to teach human evolution.
Okay.
But again, I don't know if that's really possible. I'm sure students will ask additional questions and things like that. But that was one of the recommendations. And it was just, you can go online. I can send you the link of the discussion in the Knesset where they discussed Judaism and evolution. And most of the rabbis that were brought there to discuss the issue came out against evolution.
Yeah. But still, when you look at the curriculum, even though it's optional, it's still there. You know, in writing, the evolution theory is almost a given, right?
Well, I had a class where we were teaching religious science teachers, because we've begun a seminar with a grant from a nonprofit in the United States, where myself and two colleagues go in and try to present different Jewish views on evolution. And one of the science teachers she's been teaching, I think, 30 years in the religious stream here, she said she once got a science book that had that picture of, you know, the ape progressing to the man. She said, I'm sending this right back. And that's one of the things here, because we have the different streams, apparently within the religious stream, is not taught all the time. I've had experiences with my own children in that regard.
No, I want to take it again closer to home. You talked about your own personal background as an Orthodox woman growing up in America. And you said that you see no contradiction between your religious views and the theory of evolution. Can you maybe explain why?
Okay, certainly. Well, I am definitely in the camp of Rabbi Cook and other distinguished rabbis. The rabbi who was the leader of my community, who passed away already in the 1990s, was Rabbi Joseph Soloveitchik. And he also wrote extensively on evolution. So I have to say that in this seminar, what we do is we present three rabbinic views of evolution. There's a rabbi who's writing his dissertation on Rabbi Cook's views of evolution. He presents Rabbi Cook. I present Rabbi Soloveitchik's views. And then we have another colleague who presents the Lubavitcher Rebbe's views. And Rabbi Schneerson, the Lubavitcher Rebbe, did not accept evolution. Mm. So some people also raise the question, well, if you're, you know, you're teaching a seminar that's trying to break down the boundaries and get students open to evolution and considering it, why are you also bringing an anti-evolution perspective? But we've actually found that when you teach the, also the anti-evolution perspective, some students are able to drop their guard down a little bit. They don't feel like they need to constantly be defending the anti-evolution perspective, and it actually makes them more open to hearing the pro-evolution perspective. So one of the issues is certainly literalism, because Rabbi Schneerson did contend that there should be an acceptance of the literal reading of Genesis, even though some people, you know, say, oh, that's not a Jewish view. Well, there are Jewish views, apparently, that accept the literal reading, but I'm not in that camp. So that's certainly one large obstacle that is easy to overcome for me.
Okay. Rachel Pear, I think I could have spent the rest of my life having this conversation, but I'm afraid we don't. We've run out of time. Dr. Rachel Pear, teaching assistant at the School of Education at Bar-Ilan University and a postdoctoral fellow at the University of Haifa, specializing in Jewish Orthodox attitudes to Darwinism. Thank you so much for coming in. This was really fascinating.
Thanks, Gilad. I appreciate it.
That was the Tel Aviv Review for this week. Thank you very much for listening. Also, big thanks to our technical producer, Leo Pelig. I am Gilad Halpern. I hope to be joined by you again next week for another edition of the Tel Aviv Review, a program dedicated to the word, to the thought, and to debate. Until then, do not forget to follow us on Facebook and Twitter, and of course, write with your comments and suggestions to Gilad, G-I-L-A-D, at tlv1.fm. Thanks very much. Shana Tova to you all, and see you again next week.